And we are back. It seems like Kosei's radio waves were a little shaky, so he had to disconnect and restart. It appears to be working now. At least that's what Google Translator said. I assume he just restarted his router or something to get it working again. And yeah, we have a stream now, however, so we are ready to tune into the game as both our players are getting ready. And yeah, so we see...
Yeah, there we go. That goes.
Yeah, I think it will be the first time that we see this matchup on stream. Actually, we might have had it before, but I don't really recall it too precisely. We certainly haven't seen it much. Of course, it's similar to the good old classic Pika versus ADPization, but I think, yeah, it's much more intricate than that, because in ADPization, it was just a race of who's faster and yeah, who doesn't miss a beat. But I think in this matchup, like the straight station Jirachi Prism Star version is just much more versatile and has different kinds of paths to take.
As you said, like I think the key card in the matchup is like one of the key cards that you can play if you play Combozation is the Dustmane Necrozma. I actually don't know if it is being played right now. No, it's actually not, so that's something that's interesting to note. A lot of players have been playing the Dustman that is able to snipe 60, and we've seen it on stream earlier before versus Ultimate Mewtwo, where it put in a lot of work, but Takino is choosing to not play it and instead, he's playing more YGX as an attacker of... like backup secondary attacker, which I like a lot as well, because it can do like 160 for an attachment and a metal patch, and that can sometimes be that one attack that you need that is like that doesn't cost you 3 energy to put you over the line. So, and the ability is also very useful.
Yeah, also please keep in mind those are two Japanese players, so they are sending us their game directly from them and they are very far away. So please bear with us if the picture is a bit shaky or if the quality is not too great. It seems to be lagging quite a bit right now, but I hope it gets better over the game and at least we get to see high quality, top level play, so high quality plays. The picture might be a bit lower quality in this case, but I'm personally willing to take that exchange and think it's fine.
Yes.
And yeah, Taketo of course going first with a pretty strong start, but Kosei now... Kosei-san also not looking too bad.
He is playing... like, that's interesting that he's still playing the Jirachi in Pika. I think a lot of players have dropped that. But I always was, like, a fan of Jirachi in Pika ROM. I have, like, tested the two versions next to each other recently. But, yeah, I really like Pika... like, Jirachi, because it gives yourself... like you have a good free pivot and it makes yourself a little bit more stamp proof and it has a lot of advantages, but of course it takes up a lot of space and you need to commit a lot of your engine to it. And there we see Tech Hall grabbing the Goose Mahala for the following turn. That's super nice if you're able to like the Goose Mahala searching for every piece that you need is just exactly what you want to see. On the next turn, Kosei will be able to go for Thunder Mountain, Escape Board plus energy off the Goose Mahala and get everything he needs. But Taketo now has the opportunity to attack because he got an energy attachment on the first turn and he also hit an energy off the Intrepid Sword.
Yep. And... so let's see how well Taketo can manage with this, of course. Kosei's first turn, not super impressive, no Bolton there for him, so he's kinda on a slower end. And yeah, now Taketo can definitely capitalize on this if he gets a fast opening. Now he already has his attack already, and yeah, I mean he basically has his attack already. I wonder if he actually opts to attack for Jirachi, but yeah, one prize is actually quite meaningful in this matchup since Pikachu Zekrom relies heavily on two prizes, so if you can just take a knockout on the Jirachi, and then two-shot one tag team and take a knockout on the Bolton, Zero Aura, El, the Ghost, the Dead, or something like this. Monk-Boss yep. line that gives you the game. Yeah, so just taking one prize early on is, can be very impactful in the long run.
Taketo actually found all four of his quick boards in the top like 15 cards of his deck, so that's definitely benefiting his setup right now. Being able to search for every basic Pokemon he needs. So yeah, I think setting up double Zacian here is better. If you can hit the energy of the Entropy Sword, it becomes great, I think, because then you have two Zacians ready to go, and then you can initiate the trading with the, price trade with your opponent with a very good feeling, be pretty confident that you can win the price exchange. We see Guzmahala finally. We saw it a little bit in Kim's deck for 2 weeks ago. He also played Guzmahala, so still grabbing one of the tag supporters, but it's not Kosei anymore.
Yeah, Kosei's build is—he's actually the one that popularized this build in the first place. He was the first to be successful with attack call version of Pikachu Zekrom instead of Electromagnetic Radar. It didn't really catch on after him, so not a lot of players have actually adopted this playstyle. Most people still sticked out with Electromagnetic Radar, and especially this form, it seems like that was the way to go with aggression of speed lightning energy as well. But Taketo, Kosei still sticking with his good old tag call style. No Electromagnetic Radar, just the free tag call. To get himself going, and yeah, he's certainly making a case for himself. Seems to be working out pretty well for him, but this looks like a lot of a lot of energies are gone for him.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of energies in the prize cards. Actually, I don't think a lot have hit the discard pile so far. So, not even able to get any addition. Yeah, okay, three. Never mind. So three energies in the discard pile. So you are able to get them back with the Tapu Koko Prism.
Yeah, but the low energy count definitely somewhat painful for him. If he could just use another full blitz to get more energies to play, that would be great. But like this, he probably won't reach high amounts of damage with his Bolton in the later game. So yeah, it seems like he has a very traditional build of Pikachu Zekrom, using the tag call engine, just focusing on the turn 2 full blitz, not using Bolton too much, and just relying on the strength of Pikachu Zekrom and Raichu and Alolan Raichu.
Yeah, he is playing one copy of Power Plant, so I think his main way of coming back in games where he might fall a little bit behind, it's like go for paralysis plus stem plant and lock your opponent out of the way of the game that way. So that's like always an option you have to consider when you play against Pikachu, that they can just paralyze stamp you and then you have to draw something out of it, or else you might fall behind and lose the game.
Plant, reset, stamp, always a great combination. And Taketo now has to start making a move, of course. Kosei is still not putting on huge pressure, but he has this one GX attack to take a big knockout for sure. So, and he can also tag Bolt as well. So with every time it passes, it's just more and more prizes for Kosei. And just taking more easy knockouts on those Jirachis makes it way easier for him to close out the game in the late game, because especially in this matchup, this can Pikachu Zekrom can feel very glass cannon-like, where you're strong in the early game, get a fast start, get a full blitz, and when you have your Jigs attack as well to take an easy knockout. But after that, if you don't hit if you don't reach high amounts of energies, Pikachu Zekrom can run out of steam quite easily.
Yeah. That being said, the Raichu will be able to like run away from the attack, also not be one shot as easily, so you will get some value out of that. And yeah, the Pikachu Zekrom only being hit for 210 damage here is also super nice. If you get you get another full blitz off right here, you can I don't think it's worth to go for Melon Lana, but yeah, you have the option available to you.
Yeah, but Malolana doesn't really change anything, since Taketo is not playing the Duskman across map, he has to hit Pikachu Zekrom with Navasation anyways. But I guess you can just do it to thin a few cards out of your deck, maybe.
Let's see what he grabs with the Faulkner. The Scrappers, they are also kind of important because they can get rid of the Metal Goggles on the bench. The Metal Goggles obviously reduce damage done by 30, and that is one less Electro Power that you need to take a knockout. And also getting rid of the Escape Pod from the Jirachi feels super nice.
Sure.
Let's see what Electro Power being played.
Yeah, looks like he's just gonna go for Tech Bolt here. I think we're knockout this way. And yeah, keeping his Raichu. That's what he goes for.
Yeah,
and of course,
taking the knockout here. I mean, you would have. Yeah, if you have access to stuff like the damage modifiers with the Vital Band and stuff, it can sometimes just become that little bit easier to push for the one hit knockouts on stations. But not able to get there this time without committing the GX attack.
Yeah, so that's kind of annoying. Also, like having to use the GX attack of a Pikachu Zekrom, the Raichu GX attack would have been relatively nice. Putting up, one prizer, something that Keto doesn't want to target, because right now he wants to knock out his Pikachu Zekrom, and then he wants to two-shot the Raichu and the Alolan Raichu. And yeah, if the Pika and the tag teams just are in the active all the time, it makes it much easier for Taketo. So yeah, this play kind of wastes an Electro Power for Kosei, and also like leaves Pika in the active. So if he had had a switch, it would have been pretty nice, but he also would have needed something to put up, and yeah, I guess he just didn't want to sacrifice his Jirachi and valued that getting that tool scrapper over a switch.
Yeah, very wisely from Kosei here. Like, he's denying his opponent the easy route to victory, where like you take one tag team with the combo, and then you take out one Dedenne, and then you just win the game by that, because there's no Dedenne on Kosei's bench just yet. That way, like, there's no easy way for Taketo to close out the game. But maybe we see actually the Mew Pings taking on the Pikachu, so that might be something.
Certainly possible.
Yeah,
and looks like that's what he's going for. And yeah, there's no reason not to. At this point, the Mew and the Zacian do basically the same thing, while the Mew. However, the Mew is pretty easy to knock out, so that might be a reason not to go for this. Because yeah, Kosei, if he takes a knockout on the Mew, he goes down to two prizes, and then he just needs to find double Electro Power and a switch to take out another Zacian.
I guess if you know like that your opponent has only one Electro Power used and like three remaining in his deck, and he's sitting there with like a 10 card hand, you maybe expect him to have it already in hand. But yeah, I agree with you. It would have been also been good to go for the knockout with the Zacian right here. And yeah, we see. Just a ridiculous amount of cards being drawn with the Pika right here, and the Jirachi Prism combo was being pulled off. I think he just got it off the prizes, right? He didn't put it in with Mr. Mime.
He didn't. Just got it out of the prizes like this.
Okay, just randomly drawing the Jirachi Prism out of the prizes. That's, I guess, the benefit of playing that card, right? It's sometimes you just get it, you get lucky, and then you go from there.
Yeah, now this makes it so bad. Kosei certainly doesn't want to use any two prizes anymore, and just wants to finish out this game with a Raichu and a Alolan Raichu that he has in his hand. Getting with the Dedenne, probably just holding it for the next turn.
Yeah, I would assume.
To, yeah, then. And yeah. getting an electro power as well, and he already has the reset stamp, so he will be able to disrupt Takedo quite a bit. The main reason to disrupt him here, however, I guess, is to not get disrupted yourself.
Yes, you want to keep this hand for sure. You just attack with the Raichu, I guess, and then you're basically good to go. So yeah, probably a little bit of a, as you said, a little bit of a misstep to not attack with the Zacian, because you lost a lot of resources from your opponent this turn. And Jose would have had to dig for more Electro Powers and stuff.
Yeah, like, in the end it doesn't matter that much. I mean, Kosei could have just used the boss's order, since he didn't use any supporter anyways. So, I guess he could have just bosses ordered up the Jirachi or something like that to get a bit more annoying, but yeah, the Mew seems like a weird choice. Usually it's nice to use a one prizer that just needs one energy, but I think in this case Takedo's kind of on the back foot and would have wanted to tank with something that Kosei can't easily take out. However, he's still by no means out of this. If he just gets Mani or a reset stamp this turn, that should be still a pretty decent position for him. And yeah, he does play two Mani, so that's certainly an option if he gets one. He does not play any reset stamp though.
So yeah, it would have to be that Mani coming out right here. Sometimes also those two of supporters can be a little bit tough to find when you need them, right?
So sure.
And if you don't disrupt here, then that's for bad. That's just most likely going to be a game. But
I guess what's technically possible is that he can still get the comp. Yeah, okay, I guess now a lot of supermans are gone, but if he had gotten like boss's order plus the Mr. Mime combo, that would have been an option as well.
Yeah, plus like scoop up.
And there's the Mani.
There's Mani, so finding it finally. Off the second Stellar Wish, and yeah, back goes Jose's 12 card hand, and he is left with like with only only 4. And yeah, let's see what he will be able to do if he can close out the game on the next turn. He needs one more Electro Power and a way to switch, I believe.
His hand's certainly not too great right now. I wonder why he opted to not put down more of his Pokemon last turn, like with the Poco Prism Star and the Marshadow of his skateboard. He could have gotten rid of all of that.
Yep.
I mean, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter that much because we're at the bottom of his deck. But
I mean, the Intrepid Sword here is, I think it's fine because you have the Shrine of Punishment in play and you probably know that your opponent, like you know your opponent only has one stadium left. So maybe you just, you think it's too risky to attack and you want to force the boss's order. And maybe your opponent takes long enough to find the boss till the Shrine of Punishment takes down till the Raichu is in one
shot range of the stage. That now makes it even more interesting that he didn't put on the Marshadow. If he just had the Marshadow, he could just use it now and take the knockout with Tandem Shock, and then he would be totally fine. But I guess he's still pretty safe. The Raichu doesn't get knocked out by Zacian, so if he just... I mean, I guess he could still just take the knockout on the Jirachi.
Or he could just get it, I guess. Double E power plus boss's order, doesn't that knock out the Zacian?
He has no way to switch.
You are correct.
Yeah, I think just knocking out the Jirachi would have been pretty fine. The Raichu would have gone to 240 max. So it would have still survived with 20, and then the boss's order would have likely been an out anyways, but I guess Kosei might be scared of Scoop Up Net removing the Jirachi Prism Star from the board. And so he prefers to like just get ready to take the knockout on one of those stations.
Yeah, but now if Takedo's able to pull off the combo once again, then that would be
For sure, that would be the game.
Devastating for Kosei. But, of course, there are a few Scoop Up Nets gone already. I don't know how many he has left currently, so...
He did use two on his last turn at least. Okay, so he still has one, and that's all he needs. Yep. He hasn't used his Mr. Mime yet. And he has 7 out of 19 cards available currently, so he might very well be able to get it. That's with Sonya, so that's at least with Mr. Mime. So if he has a Switch and a Scoop Up Net in his hand, that would mean the game. But nope, does not look like he has it.
Great catch, very intelligent, bringing the Raichu up so it can't as easily go back and paralyze you once again. And yeah, maybe Kosei, like, he didn't take the money on the last turn. I mean, of course you want to have the missing pieces that you need to close out the game, but maybe just getting the money and just drawing more cards, building your board, would have been the right play, because now the pieces get shuffled back anyway, your Raichu gets pulled up again, and you're basically back to square one where you were a turn ago, with more damage and being way more threatened.
And since we know that Taketo doesn't have any disruption but Mani, and we see which hand Kosei drew, we know that if he had just attacked last turn, he very likely would have just had the game right about now.
Yeah, now so, he has a Switch, but there's no escape board on the Jirachi that got removed.
Yeah.
With the two scrapper. Stellar Wish coming out. Probably the reset stamp. Reset stamp to 2. Slow, try to slow your opponent down, I guess. Replace the stadium as well, and then maybe try to rebuild from there, then get the boss order on the following turn, I guess. But yeah, no means of switching just yet, so.
And yeah, also no electro powers, so he will need quite a lot. I guess he can use Eldegoss this turn, because right about, yeah, now it doesn't matter anymore if he puts down a 2 prizer. The Raichu and the Lolan Raichu is super easy to get knockout on anyways.
Yeah, so and I think Taketo has still one boss sorta left. I think there are 2 in the discard pile for Taketo. So if there's one left, then you could use that to close out the game.
And I'm really not convinced about the way Kosei played the late game here. Of course I could be missing something, and on the other side it's also worth mentioning that it's probably, I don't know how late exactly, but it's probably around 4 or 5 a.m. for in Japan, so Kosei might be very exhausted, and I'm pretty tired as well, so I might very well be missing something, but I think
currently 4 o'clock in the morning, so in Japan, so
yeah, but I think just playing down some of his Pokemon and taking different knockouts here and there would have been pretty fine for him. Anyways.
Yeah, both players just.
And there's a boss order.
Yeah.
That's game one for Taketo.
Yeah, drawing the last boss order.
Meet it? Yeah. His deck was pretty low, though, so not too surprising.
Yep.
And yeah, so he moves up, wins game one, even though he was quite a bit on the back foot from the start on. I still think Kosei would have probably had a pretty good chance at winning if he played it a bit different, but that's it. Maybe he can like adapt a bit for the other 2 matches, games, of course, because he still has 36 minutes on the clock, and he will get the opportunity to go first.
Yep.
So yeah. And yeah, I think it's pretty interesting how the way he builds his list, the tech hall engine and the power plant, just completely different. It looks like this is the middle, like we've seen the greens version and we've seen the aggressive Dedenne version mostly on stream, and it seems like the 2 extremes. And yeah, what in the end seems to be the most successful one is exactly in between those extremes. It's like it has some searching with Mahala and the tech call, and it has some disruption from a power plant, but it also still has Jirachi and Dedenne as engine, so
getting the best of both worlds, I guess.
Quite interesting to see Kozmi make it this far with his build.
Yeah, we're currently waiting on the setup for game 2, so...
Yeah, players are getting ready, figuring out who goes first, and... Not really sure if they're maybe confused about something. I guess they're writing in the Smash chat and communicating about game 2 and getting that on the way. Kozmi is definitely ready to challenge his opponent once again and see that. Hopefully they get it done in time, because this game already took like 25 minutes. So if I were Kozmi, I would be hurrying up right about now.
Yes.
But I guess in the end, time is not really a big disadvantage, and both of those decks are relatively aggressive, so hopefully this won't go to time.
Yeah, now we see. Now they're ready. The challenge has been sent, so we should. I should be starting soon. And yeah, I think general like composition is really the one deck that can, I feel like, abuse ScoopUpNet the most. Because ScoopUpNet is just such a super broken card without any drawback, right? You just get to put it back into your hand, no cost, no questions asked. And I think composition is probably the deck that I think at least uses ScoopUpNet the best and the most, which is kind of funny. Sensation is a two price attacker that can't even be scooped up with the net itself, but giving yourself the options of Jirachi and Prism Star, but also conserving your switches to get out of the Brave Blade attack by using scoop up nets on your regular Jirachis is super super important, and it is always super key to maintaining a clear path to victory.
Yeah, certainly a very good build, and pretty much dominating our top 8 here. Azul playing a very similar build, a very similar deck as Taketo, made it to the finals, and Taketo is 1-0 up. So he has one foot in the final already, just need the second win. So we see a Zacian Mirror in the finals, certainly possible, and definitely a testimony to the strength of this deck. Now,
last time we had Pika Mirrors, this time we might have Zacian Mirrors, you know?
Yeah, Kozmi start definitely not great.
No energy.
Just the pass, no energy, and he doesn't want to waste those resources to go for Dene. Goes for the more. Yeah, realizes that he gets the Electrify turn 2 anyway, so I guess he just values a more conservative approach more.
And I believe that card.
And Vasonia, let's go!
Nice.
That's exactly why this card is in his deck. Just getting those Pokemons on turn 1. Because, I've talked about this deck with Robin quite a bit. Because it's his favorite deck of the format. Currently, my favorite deck is Zacian Mercario. It's a very similar build, but instead of extra prizes, I prefer Disruption and Healing. Other than that, pretty similar builds. And yeah, Robin said, like, already considered playing Pokeball because, he played Communication so far, and Trend Ball's not too great since so many people don't play Jirachi anymore these days. And yeah, those Japanese players like Taketo, and we've seen some others as well, bringing up Zonia to have more options for getting those, to get those Zacian turn 1. And it's basically everything this deck needs to get going and get into the game.
That's a really nice intrepid sword. And yeah, hitting 2 energy there, super good. And also, I think the card that went to the prize cards must have been a Jirachi Prism of that Mr. Mime. So I think the Jirachi Prism might already be in the prize cards. And Taketo certainly has built a really, really strong board on the first turn. You know, when you only need basic Pokemon and basic energy on your first turn, and actually Sonia becomes a really, really good supporter if you have one or the other in your hand and you can search for the other piece and then just go from there.
Yeah, so we basically see the complete reverse. Kozmi having a terrible start, at least not having a useless hand, but no energy attachment on turn 1, and on the other side, Taketo getting the Jirachi Prism Star ready. into the prizes and getting his station with free energy turn one, while also, yeah, having Jirachi on board, having Oranguru on board, having those metal goggles to have the station be a bit more bulky. Yeah, certainly a really good opening.
Yeah, I really like the metal goggles. I think that was a really good call for this tournament. I would have expected a lot of Dragapult as well. Research after we saw only a little bit at the last qualifier. I expected it to get stronger, and yeah, making the call that Beyblacephalon would go down and Dragapult would go up and play certainly paid off for Takeru. He stomped a few Dragapults on his way to top 8. Let's put it that way. Kosei just getting ready for an Electrify this turn. Yes, so I think
interesting that he attaches the energy to the Pika, so it looks like he was going for a full blitz. Just for Electrify. Yeah, it makes sense that he attached to Pika because when he already has switching quick ball, so if he had gotten a basic energy with this with the speed energy, he could have just gone for a full blitz. Unfortunately didn't get it and just has to go for Electrify, so really slow start here for Kosei. And now Takeda will probably have the option to already take 3 prizes on this Bolton.
Yes, and that's exactly where you want to be. And you also, like, now it's super important that you get another Zacian down and you attach another energy to it. Because then you only need another metal source of this energy on the following turn to be able to attack once again, and that would apply a huge amount of pressure. So it's definitely looking for Zacian plus metal energy here, and to like get ready. And maybe you can also, like, this time Takeru got the combo off quite early in the game, and maybe if he pulls the Jirachi Prism out of the prizes, then he can just go for double scoop up net and then, yeah, go again, put the Jirachi back, and then draw extra prizes once again. So that's certainly something he could have an eye on.
Yeah, quite a lot of switching cards going into the discard pile for Takeru for switch, a scoop up net, now another switch being used. And that's always one of the weaknesses of Zacian decks. Of course, the Jirachi Prism Star build is a bit better with this, because there you don't need that many attacks, like the version I like to play with Mercario. Yeah, you need a lot of switching and you need to attack quite a lot, so it's always really annoying when you get rid of switching cards. But yeah, just having to switch in the discard pile always is also pretty annoying here.
Yeah, I mean, if you research anyway, then like, it feels bad, but there's nothing you can do about it. And actually, no Jirachi Prism out of the prizes because there is no bench space available currently.
It makes a lot of sense. Takeru is just valuing getting the 2 Zacian set up. Yep. And yeah, otherwise he wouldn't have had space for the Zacian or for the Mew. And yeah, he just values this option. Now he knows that he won't fall behind anymore because of Tech Bolt. And he's also getting ready to attack. And yeah, if he can just 2-shot one of those tech teams, he will then get his Jirachi Prism Star out of the prizes later on and just win the game that way. And it also is better against reset stamps, so certainly a very reasonable play here.
Yep. Shrine of Punishment also doing some important ping damage, and forcing Kosei to get the stadium replacement here. And yeah, he's probably looking at a full blitz, but I think it's unlikely that you get the one shot here. You would need like a whole ton of electric powers. So yeah, favorable price trade for Takeru for sure. Big jump coming down, but it's not as reliable anymore for the plus 30 HP since Tool Scrapper is a thing now, and tools can be removed easily.
Yes, and we saw that both players are valuing this option and are running Tool Scrapper in their deck. Yeah, just a very useful option, as there are many, many powerful tools in the format right now.
Just and getting rid of Escape Ward also seems like sometimes can be really huge.
Yeah, for sure. It's like an ARP, so. And most decks these days only run one Escape Ward anyways, since they have so many switching cards with Scoop Up Nets.
Yep.
But it's pretty impactful. And yeah, Kose. Now, he did remove a Shrine of Punishment, so that's important for sure, otherwise the speaker would have just gotten knocked out very easily. The big time here not doing that much. It's gonna get two shot anyways.
At least you prevent the ping from the Mew, I guess. Like, you don't get pinged from Mew by four prizes.
Yeah, that's true. That would be a pretty funny end, actually.
I mean, it is possible, I think, so. Yeah, boss's order coming out here. Bringing up the Zacian. I have to say, I don't really like this a whole bunch, because it moves the Zacian to the bench, and then it is. And then you can just attack with Brave Blade once again. Otherwise, if the Zacian stays active, then you maybe have trouble to. Yeah, I mean, you can maybe switch it out, right? But it's probably a little bit hard to switch it back in again. The Zacian might just get stuck in the active for one turn.
I mean, Kose probably saw that Takedo discarded two switch last. Discard one switch, used another switch. And now figures that if he just finds, he has a lot of metal sources left, so if he just retreats and attacks, that's relatively easily possible. And however, there's the switch, and yeah, so I guess this was somewhat of a desperation move for Kose, knowing that he needs some more time, that he's falling behind quite considerably. But yeah, it's looking rough for sure now.
But Takedo needs to hit a scoop up net as well to give himself the bench spot that he needs to put down the Jirachi Prism, so that's important. He needs to hit one of those. But I believe there are a bunch left in his deck, so.
Yeah, and Kose will eventually have to take a knockout on monetizations anyways, I guess. I mean, maybe he wants to attack with Pika to make sure that he doesn't take a knockout and gamble on Takedo not having a scoop up net to free a spot on his bench.
Maybe you go for like a paralysis here, hope your opponent can't switch, and then go for a tech void on the following turn. Ah, there's a Mew. Don't mind me.
Otherwise, we would have easily been the play. But yeah, in this case, doesn't really do too much.
Unfortunate. Yeah, Mew. Pesky Mew. I think pretty nice inclusion. Like, a lot of players giving Pika the respect it deserves by including the Mew, and it's just a pretty easy way to give yourself a little bit of an advantage, a little bit more wiggle.
Yep, and now I wonder what the best line of play is for Kose, I guess. He can just take the knockout of Quartz and hope that Takedo doesn't have a gusting effect. And then he can just take a knockout on the other Zacian on the following turn and hope that Takedo doesn't get another attacker up. But, and yeah, it seems like his line of play, just taking the knockout here. And yeah, that's probably better. I guess the odds of Takedo having a scoop up net are higher than him having a boss's order, since he can just play a supporter and go out of that.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, now Takedo has the Stellar Wish available to him to maybe find the last boss order. I mean, he's playing three, so the chances, I would assume, that he finds one are pretty high. We see some players only playing two boss order, some players playing three, and I think in Zacian, having access to more Gust is always super good. Because
I mean, it is not that easy. He has 30 cards in his deck, he only has 5 cards in his hand, and he needs like a free card combination of like switch energy, boss's order, and he doesn't have access to the Dende, since there's power plant in play, and he used his only stadium already with being the Shrine of Punishments. So yeah, he might well not have the attack here, and it looks like he's just going for an Interpret Sword from, if I had to guess.
Yeah, missing the switch here. He got the boss of the Jirachi.
Yeah, but, and
you're not under so much pressure. You're pretty safe. Your Zacian is pretty safe on the bench. Your opponent can either take away the boss from your hand by using Armani or take out the Zacian on your bench. They can't really do both. Unless they play like a reset stamp as well and a boss's order, but that would be yeah, quite a lot to ask for, so let's see.
Yeah, an interesting thing that Kosei could do is use Elder Gods for Mallow and Lana and then heal once again. It would mean getting rid of most of his hand, but it would completely heal his Pikachu once again. I mean, he could still keep like two cards in his hand for Mani plus one other card. So that might be a good play for him, just to make sure that his tag team gets healed up again, and then it's harder for Takedo to keep it. When Kagedo still needs two attacks, so he still needs to charge up two attackers, so that might be a good play.
Yep. Now looking what to get of the Silver Witch, I like attack switch, because that maybe it makes you able to set up another attacker that can be useful. Because that Raichu has 5 energies on it, and you have used your GX attack already, so you're never going to make use of the 5 energies on the Raichu. So yeah, I like that being grabbed right here. Elder Ghost coming down. Let's see what he grabs. He just grabs the boss, so...
So I guess he figures that Malolana is not worth going for. Instead, he wants to pressure Takeda a bit more. Taking a knockout here on the Zacian. Of course, that's a little bit awkward that he had to use a switch for that. And ooh, he opts to go in with the Pika.
Saying basically, if you have Metal Saucer Energy Switch, then it's just over. But I guess, I think it's maybe correct to go with the Raichu. I mean, you know that your opponent has the boss in hand anyway, but now he can just play supporter as well to go for the Metal Energy Saucer Switch combo. And I think if you have access to something like a Research or a Mani, then you're certainly going to be able to hit it. This deck is just built to hit combos like this, so... Zacian, I mean.
For sure. However, the power blend definitely crippling his draw options here. So he's limited to just Stellar Wish and his supporters. And of course, we don't know for sure that the Jirachi Prism Stars in his price. We just assume that he did put it there.
Sure.
Might have been that he had something important priced and wanted to get it out, but I guess he's also playing relatively confidently.
Yeah, there's the scoop up net, scooping up the Jirachi, so we will see if the effect of Jirachi will the prizes, and if that extra prize card will be... Yeah.
There it is.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's the game. And Takedo Seki takes this game to this match 2-0 over Kosei Saito's Pikachu Zekrom. So he now has beaten 2 Pika back-to-back, Justin Boca. And not just any 2 Pikas, Justin Bokari in top 8, and now Kosei in top 4. So two amazing and very accomplished Pikachu Zekrom players. So the Jirachi, the Zacian Jirachi deck certainly showing that it's very capable of taking down Pika. And it will be facing off against Azul in the finals. So both playing the same, Zacian with Jirachi Prism Star. And yeah, so it seems like this might actually overcome Pikachu Zekrom as the best deck in form, and of course it's very early, so it's so we can't call which deck is the best yet. But since the other game finished, we shouldn't take too long to set up the top 8. So we will first go through a quick break of our great sponsors, especially TCG player who came in and managed and sponsored this qualifier last minute. So big thanks to them for helping us out and providing the prize pool for this. And here